والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي وثمرة فؤادي أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين الذين أذاب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
فجعلت تلك سورة الفاتحة فلسورة الحجابة هي الخور وزعفار حسين من الله بالنسبة للسول الفاتحة. Another request of Surah Al-Fatiha for all our marhumin, marhumat. May Allah be pleased with all of them. Al-Fatiha. Another Surah Al-Fatiha for ourselves when we become marhumin. May Allah be pleased with all of us. Al-Fatiha. صلوا على محمد وعلى آل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد.
قال الله العلي العظيم في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يوصيكم الله في أولادكم للذكر مثل حظ الأنثيين، فإن كن نساء فوق اثنتين فلهما ثلثا ما ترك، وإن كانت واحدة فلها النصف، ولأبويه لكل واحد منهما السدس، مما ترك إن كان له ولد، فإن لم يكن له ولد وورثه أبواه فلأمه الثلث، فإن كان له إخوة فلأمه السدس، من بعد وصية يوصي بها أو دين. آباؤكم وأبناؤكم لا تدرون أيهم أقرب لكم نفعا، فريضة من الله، إن الله كان عليما حكيما. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
This ayah that I just read is in Surah An-Nisa, the chapter of women, ayah 12. And it's one of the ayahs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the inheritance. When somebody passes away, male or female, Islam have designed the system how the inheritance should take place. And you know, inheritance have been a big problem in every nation before Islam. Among the Arab before Islam, what they used to do with the inheritance is that when somebody passes away, the strongest one comes and takes everything. Later on, as they develop, they become more civilized, they stop attacking. But what do? Especially if it's a sister. She's wealthy, she has money, inherited from her parents. A man comes in the name of marriage. He marries her. As soon as she marries her, let's say, he gets control on the money, then the woman is pushed aside until she died. To put a pressure on her, torture until she died, then he takes everything. That's why in Surah An-Nisa also, Allah says, لا يحل لكم أن ترثوا النساء كرها. It's haram to inherit a woman by force or to inherit someone by force. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Prophet came and Islam started, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet how inheritance should take place. When somebody dies, how whatever the person leaves behind, how should it be distributed among the living people? For that matter, I just want to emphasize about this a little bit because inheritance is a vast topic. We cannot finish everything here, but we just try our best to talk about the key point. So at least we have an idea what is the inheritance and how Islam have systemized the inheritance in Islam. Number one, what is the meaning of inheritance? In Islam is called al-irth. What does it mean? The word irth. They said al-irthu inheritance huwa ma yujibu li shakhsin bi mawti shakhs. Is what somebody gets because of somebody's death. Meaning inheritance, it only occurs when somebody dies. For that matter, if I am alive and I give something to somebody, then I die later on, whatever the person gets is not called inheritance, it's called gift. The inheritance only applies after somebody dies. Then I inherit whatever he has or whatever she has. Or after I die, somebody takes whatever I have, it's called inheritance. This inheritance, it has two causes, meaning somebody cannot inherit any person. People cannot inherit one another unless there are two reasons. Two reasons are the cause of inheritance. One is called a nasab, the second is called a sabab. It's easy to remember. Nasab, sabab, they're close to each other. A nasab is the blood relationship. Otherwise, if somebody dies, let's say in China or in Africa, I don't relate to them. Do I have entitled to go inherit? No. The only reason that can allow me to inherit somebody after they die is if we have a blood relationship, a brother, a sister, a grandfather, that I have the access to inherit. That is number one. Number two, they call it a sabab. It's the cause. And what is the cause? The cause is marriage. Marriage is one of the reasons to allow somebody to inherit somebody. Otherwise, a sister, a brother, they don't have any blood relationship. A husband dies, he has to inherit for what cause? The only reason that Islam allows a woman to inherit a man or a man to inherit a woman is because they have marriage together. Now, which marriage are we talking about? Because we have two marriages in Islam. One is called da and one is called munqata, right? Temporary. In Islam, a temporary wife does not inherit. Only the permanent marriage. Unless in the temporary marriage, unless if the prior agreement was made. Before then, a woman said, I want to inherit you after you die, or I want you to inherit me. Either the both agreement. Then if one dies, even though it's a temporary marriage, then they can inherit one another. But if no agreement made before that, there is no inheritance between a husband and wife if the marriage is temporary. It only applies in permanent marriage. That is number two. So the first one, you got the definition of inheritance. Number two, you got also what we call the cause of inheritance. Number three, we call it mawani al-irth. What can prevent somebody to inherit someone? Because sometimes I deserve to inherit brother. A brother deserves to inherit me. But some things can happen that he or she cannot inherit. And there are three things. Number one, one of the things that can prevent somebody from inherit is called al-qatl, killing. If I kill somebody, I supposed to inherit them. There is inheritance between us. I kill the person, I have no any, even one penny. Islam says you're not allowed to take that. It's haram on you to inherit that person. That is number one. Cause number one that prevents somebody to inherit is called موانئ الإرث. Number two is called الكفر. When a father and a son are two people who are supposed to inherit each other, but they both are on two separate religion. A father is a Muslim. The son changed their religion, right? Or the son is a Muslim, but the father is not a Muslim. They cannot inherit each other. It's haram. They cannot. However, here, look at the beauty of Islam. If the father is a Muslim, but the son is not a Muslim, Islam says if the son dies, the father has the right to inherit the son. But not the other way around. The son who's not a Muslim cannot inherit the father who's a Muslim. Or the other way around. Meaning if there is a family, one of them is Muslim, the other one is not a Muslim. The Muslim can inherit the non-Muslim, but the non-Muslim cannot inherit the Muslim. That is Islamic teaching. That is why when you go to Khutbat al-Zahra alayhi salam, after the falak was taken from her, if you read the khutbah, she made the reason from this point. When she talked to the first Khalifa Abu Bakr, she says, أَوَلَسْتُ أَنَا وَأَبِي عَلَى مِلَّةٍ وَاحِدٍ. Isn't me and my father on the same religion? Because she knows if the Prophet was a Muslim and she was not, then yes, she's not entitled to that. But she is a Muslim, she was a Muslim, her father was a Muslim, then there is she has all the right to inherit her father. Then Abu Bakr said, I heard the Holy Prophet said, نحن معشر الأنبياء, we the Prophet, when we die, whatever we leave behind is sadaqah. Nobody's allowed to inherit. Zahra alayhi salam, she said, okay, is that what you say, ya Abu Bakr? Let me ask you in the Quran, didn't Allah say, وَوَرِثَ سُلَيْمَانُ دَاوُودِ. Dawood inherited his father, Sulaiman. Sulaiman was a prophet, his father was a prophet, he died. Whatever the father left, Sulaiman didn't say, oh, it's a sadaqah, give it to others. And Quran confirmed, he said, he inherited everything his father left. So why is it that other prophets, other people can inherit, but I cannot inherit my father? And that was the clear evidence that there was a political reason which prevent them from giving Zahra alayhi salam the right. For that matter, the second reason that prevents somebody from inheriting someone they supposed to inherit is called al-kufr, being on different religion. Number three, if a child is born outside marriage, there's no inheritance as well between the parents and the child. Yes, the child is not committing any sin, but Islam says that child cannot inherit. However, there are some scholars who said the mother has the inheritance. There's inheritance between the mother and the child, but not between the child and the father. That is considered also number three of the things that prevent someone from inheritance. Now, number four, when somebody passes away, we want to inherit. There are processes we have to follow. It's not like he dies and that's it, we can take everything. No. The first thing we have to do, Islam said, is called we have to check the deceased, the marhum or marhuma, does she or he has any haqqullah upon their name before they die. Before we say anything, we cannot give anybody money. Despite one can be so desperate, but we cannot give them anything. First, we have to do, we have to go and check. Marhum, does he have haqqullah? Haqqullah means, has he at one point failed to pay any of Islamic dues? Khums, nadr. That's the first thing. If we found that, yes, marhum didn't pay khums for the rest of the, for the years. Before we say anything, we have to take that khums out and pay to the hakim al-shara or to the wakil or to the marja and then come and look whatever is left, then we can proceed from there. But the first important thing that comes is haqqullah. That is number one. After we finish with the haqqullah, then we come to haqqun nas, the second part. And that is, we have to check, is any person, Muslim, kafir, has he owes any person money? Has he ever taken a loan from someone or not? But here, let me make it clear, brothers and sisters. Because some of us here, especially in America, unfortunately, there is misconception, misunderstanding about the true Islam. Some people believe that if I take a loan from non-Muslim, it's okay not to pay. I can take a credit card, right? And I can swipe it as much as I want. At the end of the day, I don't have to pay. Why? Because they are kuffar. A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. It's haram in Islam. It doesn't matter, even if the person is in 8 years, even if the person is not a Muslim, it's still haram for a Muslim to take a penny of that person. It's not allowed in Islam. So if we know a brother, a sister, a mar'um, he owes a person a penny, a money, then we have to take from that and make sure that it's paid off. Even if whatever he left behind or she left behind will cost everything he owns, and the children will be left any with nothing, that is what has to be done. That is how Haqqullah is very important. Haqqullah and Haqqunnas comes first. After we finish with Haqqullah, then there's a second part we have to share. Before we give anything, then we come to second haq, and it's called Haqq wajibul mali wal badan. Has he has any wajib that has to do with the money and the body at the same time, which is known like Hajj. At one point, if somebody was able to go to Hajj, but they didn't go for no good reason. Here, before we distribute anything to those who will inherit, we have to make sure that we take that second part. We cannot give to anybody whatever the marhum left, unless Haqqullah, the second part, which is al-wajib al-mali wal-badali, has to be paid off. That is number three. Number three. The next thing we have to do is, we have to go back and check. The marhum, does he has what we call al-wajib al-badali. Wajib al-badali is the wajib, that namaz. And here, the difference is here. Because here Islam, and I want brothers and sisters to listen to this carefully. Because see, the first and the second one, there is no choice. Whether the marhum wrote in the will or didn't write, Islam said the first thing we have to do, we have to pay those two off. But the third one, Islam say if the marhum, the person, any one of us, if you and I, we are smart enough to write in our will, smart, right? To write in our will, then it has to be done according to the will. But if we did not write it in our will, Islam said, then the choice belongs to the children or people who are supposed to inherit. If they said, yes, we will pay somebody to pray on his behalf, we will pray somebody to fast on his behalf, then it's their choice. If they said, no, we don't want to hire somebody to do that, we want our money, right? Islam said they have the right to. But if you and I are smart and we wrote it in our will, then they cannot say no. Because this is one of the rights Allah gives to every human being. And it's like use it or lose it. If you use it by writing it down, then nobody can challenge you. Because every human being, before the death, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, one third of your wealth is yours, right? It's your right, it's yours. You have the right to do anything you want to do with it. You want to give it as a gift to somebody. You want to add it to your daughter. You want to give more to your son. You want to give to your sister, to neighbor. You want them to build something on your behalf after you. Anything you want to, Islam say, that is your right. But that right has a limit until you say something about it. If you don't, Islam say, then we give that right to your children or to those who are supposed to inherit. If they decided to go that route, that's fine. If they say no, Islam say, I can't force them. That is in the third one. The fourth one is called al-hiba al-amma, general gift. General gift means Islam also allows you and every one of us that sometimes in life, there are certain people who cannot inherit you. They don't have the right. They don't have the right to inherit you. But you have a very good relationship with them. They played a big role in your life. They helped you so much. And you want them to have something. Because sometimes you see some people, they have children, right? They become old. And then they have somebody among the family comes and dedicate their life to take care of them. Their children are busy doing certain things. The person helping them doesn't have any right of inheritance. Now the person who gets help, the older person, whether it's a woman or a man, later on they fail to do something good for this person who have done so much for them. Now this person who helped them, they don't have right to inherit. But what can they do for them? Islam says you have the right to write in your will that I want out of my one third to be given to this person who has helped me a lot in my life. And it's called Al-Hibal'a. And this can be gone to any person. Even sometimes the person is kafir, the person is Jew, it's anything he can be. Sometimes it can be among your children. I have 4 or 5 children. One of them is more obedient than the others. I have one child who is always there for me. I want to just give them something extra. Can I do that? Islam says, sure, you can. Right? For that matter, Islam opened that door, that in that one, in that the fourth part, Al-Hibal Amma, you can choose to write anything and give it to anybody as long as it's within one third. You cannot exceed one third. Only one third. You can write anything within that, and that is your right. That's called Al-Hibal Amma. Now, before we get to the deep part of this topic, can a father or a mother say, I don't want one of my children to inherit me because they have a bad habit. They are bad to me. They don't listen. They don't care about me. They don't come to me. They don't listen. They don't obey. Can I write in my will, this son, this daughter should not inherit me? Can I do that? Yes, you can. But is it effective? The answer is no. Disobedience is not a reason to prevent a child from inheritance. Disobedience is not a reason to prevent any person who's supposed to inherit. Disobedience cannot stop the person from inheritance. The only thing is the three that we mentioned. Other than that, nothing can prevent somebody. Yes, their disobedience is between them and Allah, Yawm al-Qiyamah. That they have to answer Allah. Why they disobey their parents? Why they did not listen? They have to answer. But in terms of the children, can they disobedient? Can that be a reason not to inherit? The answer is no. They have the right to inherit Islamic. Now, after we finish with these four, then we come to the inherit part. Whatever the person has, now we can distribute among three classes. Class number one is called At-Tabaqa Al-Ula. Class one, that's the first class, the one who come first. That if any person pass away, as long as this first class are there, then the second class doesn't get anything. Third class doesn't get anything. Everything goes to the first class, that's it. And who are the first class? The first class are the parents of the deceased. If the parents are still alive, that's number one. Number two is the children. Parent and the children. That's it. Anybody else cannot inherit as long as these people are. And even in the first class, let's say there is nobody, just one person, one daughter, the person dies, no mom, no dad, just the daughter. The daughter takes everything. Second class cannot get anything. It just goes to the first class. That's it. That is number one. But a woman, a wife, she will inherit with every level. Meaning, if a man dies and he has one son and wife, the wife will inherit with also the son. If a man dies, there is nobody in the first class, just the second class, the woman inherit with the second class. If a man dies, there is no second class, no first, no second, it's the third class, the woman inherit with the third class as well. And that is how Islam preserves and make sure that a woman's right is always kept in Islam. Doesn't matter. First class are there, she has the right too. She's gonna take her right, and they take their right. If there's no first class, the second class, she takes their right, her right, and they take theirs. No second class, third class, she takes hers, and they take theirs too. That's the first class. Now, who are the second class? The second class, they call Al-Ajdad Wal-Aqwat. The grandparents, and the sisters and the brothers. Also, if there is no children, no parents, then it goes to the second class. The second class, if the grandparents are alive, they also inherit the grandson or granddaughter, plus the brothers and the sisters of deceased. That's the second class. Now, if this second class, one person was alive, let's say just a grandma or grandpa, one of them, she takes everything. If no, just the brothers, one sister, one brother, she takes everything. Now, if there is nobody in the second class, no brother, no sister, no grandparents, then it goes to the third class. And third class are al-a'mami wal-akhwal, uncles and aunts. Aunts and the family, they inherit, and plus the uncles as well. Now, if there is no first class, no second class, no third class, who inherit them? Now, if the aunts and the uncles have children, like cousins, then they take it. But if none of those also exist, then it goes to the Hakim al-Shar'i, the Imam al-Zaman, inherits the person. They say, Imam inherits any person who does not have anybody to inherit them. And you know, think about this carefully, brothers and sisters. You know, in America, it's the same system too. In America, when somebody dies and they have nobody to inherit, who takes everything? The state. The state comes and says, okay, since you don't have anybody, I take it. Maybe I don't know, Allah knows. Maybe this is from Islam. That Islam have set this rule for so many years that if somebody dies, nobody to inherit, Islamic state takes the responsibility of inheriting everything. That is these three levels. Now, brothers and sisters, as you know, if a person dies and he or she has just the boys, we have no problem. Everything is distributed among the boys equally. If the person dies and he has only daughters, everything is distributed among the daughters equally. Nobody gets more, nobody gets less. And just because I'm older doesn't mean I'm getting more. Just because he or she is younger doesn't mean they're gonna get less. No. Nope. Even let's say a person dies and he has a son who is 40 years old and he has another son who is 1 day old. Guess what? 40 years old and 1 day old, they get the same thing equally. So when I started getting white beard, why would I share the same thing with the son? Too bad. You are a son as he is a son. You get equally, no problem. That is, if they are both old, they're young. But the only problem we have, if the person dies and he or she has boys and girls. Yes, Islam says, and the ayah we just read, ayah number 12 in Surah An-Nisa, لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. Islam said then a woman get less than the boy. If there are boy, one boy, two girls, whatever is given to the two girls, they combine give to a brother. Meaning, let's say a man dies, he has two daughters and one son, and he left behind $200. How would we divide it? We say 50 goes to one sister, 50 goes to one sister, and then the $100 goes to the boy. Now the question comes, how can this be fair in Islam? We're all children. It's our father. Why is it that they get more and we get less? Shouldn't we get the same equality? Islam said, yes, it's equality. Why not? It is. What's the point? Is it because I'm a woman, I get less, and he's a man, he gets more? No, that is not the case. Islam divide these rights based on reasoning. And you know our Islam is the religion of Aql. What is the reason? Why Islam? Suddenly Islam gives more, because especially here in America, it's very hard to understand. Because here a woman says, what is the difference between us and them? They work and we work, right? Why do they get more and we get less? Not only that, and some families, you have sisters are the breadwinners, right? They make more money than the husband. But why would she get less? Shouldn't that be something to consider? She was harder than him. Now, shouldn't that get, she got more, and she get more, and he get less? Islam say no. Islam say yes. The reason why you get more, or he get less, or you, whatever, get more or less,
There is a wisdom behind it.
Now, in answering this question, why a sister get less and the brother gets more in inheritance? They ask Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi
salam.
Ya Ibn Rasulullah, what is the wisdom? Why Islam divide this in the Quran in that way? Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he answered saying the reason behind it is here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already gave that half that the sister doesn't get in inheritance is already given somewhere else. Where? I said, when a woman is getting married, she received mahar. And the mahar, Allah made it wajib upon the man to pay to her. And she gets to choose what she wants. Right? So a man has to spend when he wants to get married. So for that matter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, one, you're already taking something here, right? Two, when she comes to in the husband's house, who has to spend on her? A husband too, right? A husband is the one responsible to spend on her on his wife. Even, and now let me say this, I know brothers will not be happy to hear this, but this is the fact and we have to tell the fact. In Islam, it doesn't matter how much a woman makes. Whatever she makes is her own money. She doesn't have to help her husband in daily or the family expenses. Islam is in her money. She can have billions of dollars in her account, and I make less than $1,000 a month, and still have the right to question you to pay for everything, and still have her money. If she chose to help the expenses, that is out of her kindness. But she doesn't have to. The expenses, because mashallah, today it becomes a big deal. And the family that some brothers, they want the sisters to pay. If you don't pay, it becomes a chaos. No, Islamically, she doesn't have to. Islamically, it's the responsibility of the husband. Even if the husband has to make 2-3 jobs. Even if he has to pay, he has to take 7 jobs to sleep on the street to make sure that the family are okay. They have the roof on their head, food on the table. Islam said that is your job. And the sister, you don't have to. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has subsidized here. Al-mahar, the man has to pay. Expenses, he has to pay, right? So here Islam said, when the inheritance comes, we have two people here. One of them, he always spend. One of them, always take. Now, who should we give more? The one who takes or the one who spends more? That's okay, of course, the one who always takes more. Right? The one who spends. So if the woman is the one who pays more, of course we will. But in the case Islam said, I didn't make it wajib upon you. I made it wajib upon him. So he is the one who needs help. But here is the most important part. Islam said, not only that he takes more and you get less. So that is, and Islam said, no. Even when he takes more in the inheritance, where is he going to spend it, by the way? Is it in his pocket or in the family? Whatever he has is coming back to the sister. So at the end of the day, a sister is getting more than the man in any case. Because the mahar is there, the expenses is there, and then when they share the inheritance, whatever she has, she gets to keep hers. But whatever he has to spend on himself and the family as well. That's why Islam says, لِلذَكَرِ مِثْلُ حَذِّ الْأُنْفَيَيْنِ. But don't forget here, Islam has opened one door that if a father or a mother, you want to be kind to your daughter, to give her more, Islam says you can do that. Remember in the fourth we said, الْهِبَ الْعَامَ, general gift. A father or a mother can write in their will that I want this amount of money, this amount of property, just to go to my daughter or my son or whoever he might be, to be out of my kindness to them. If you feel in your heart that no, I don't think it's fair, I want my daughter to get more, you can do that. But if I did not do that and I pass away and I die, Islam said the distribution of this has to be according to Islamic teaching. Who gets more, who gets less? It has to be according to the Quranic teaching. And then there is something also called hajib in inheritance. And hajib means prevent. Sometimes in the inheritance, somebody can and can prevent somebody from inheritance. And that is when there is someone who is supposed to be in the first, but then, for example, they thought he might not be there, who is not there, and then later on they find he's still there. Then they have to give back to whatever they took. That is what's called inheritance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided in Surah An-Nisa how much the mother gets when there is children. How much the father gets when there is children. How much they get, both of them parents, how much do they get when there is no children. Now quickly, Islam mentioned, if a person dies and there is no children, it's just a wife and the parent. The wife always gets 1/4. It's called a ruba. Whatever the property is, 1/4 is for the woman. It's always kept for the woman. The parents, they automatically get a sudus, 1/6. Then if there is children, but if there is no children, then they get 1/3. And then the rest of them, they go back to them also, and it's called a rent. Because when we divide, we say, you take this. This is assuming if there are children. But if they are not children, then whatever is left, we go back and give it to the children. Or whoever is alive, if that person is alone, then we take everything and give it back. That is the summary about inheritance in Islam. And inheritance, it belongs to every human being in Islam. Even our imams, they inherit too. In Ziyarat Warid, when we read the Ziyarah, what do we say to Imam? As-salamu alayka ya waritha Adama Safwatillah. Oh, peace be upon you, Imam Hussein. He who inherited Adam alayhi salam. As-salamu alayka ya waritha Nuhin Nabiyillah. Then, oh, peace be upon you, he who inherited Nuh alayhi salam. As-salamu alayka ya waritha Ibrahim Khalil. And that is Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. But Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, they don't inherit money or position. What they inherit is ilm. And that's why when we ziyara, Imam Hussein alayhi as-salam didn't inherit anything from Nuh alayhi as-salam in terms of the cloth or house. What he inherited was the knowledge of Ahlul, the knowledge of Nuh alayhi as-salam, the knowledge of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam, and so on. And Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, like Imam Hussein alayhi as-salam, who inherited all the prophet. But on the day of Ashura, they did not even look or take consideration about these personalities. Even though inherit everything that all the prophet had, but they did not allow, they did not even look at what Allah has given to Imam Hussein. Even not only that, even what we call common sense of every human being, they did not even use that towards Imam Hussein alayhi salam. That one of the common sense that when you want to kill somebody, at least you have to have a conscience of being nice and kind. But the enemies of Ahlul Bayt and Imam Hussein, they were not kind to Imam Hussein. That they brought Imam Hussein alayhi salam to the Karbala against his will when he wanted to go to Kufa. They forced Imam Hussein to come to Karbala. Imam Hussein alayhi salam asked them, if you don't want me to go to Kufa because I was invited, then let me go back to the city of my grandfather, Medina. He said, no, we are not going to let you go back here. And that is when Sukaina, salamullah alayha, she asked her father, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Ya Aga, why don't you send us back to the haram of our grandfather? Imam Hussein alayhi salam said, Ya Bunayya, Ya Binti, oh my daughter, لو ترك الفتى لغضب. He said, if I had that option, I would have done that. Because I'm not giving that choice. They brought Imam Hussein and his family to Karbala. They put them under the pressure. To the point where 3 days, there was not even a drop of water in the tent of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Children were crying, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. But there is no water in the tent. The brother of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Abu al-Fadl Abbas, he came to his brother. Say, Ya Sayyidi, Abu al-Fadl Abbas always called his brother, oh Sayyidi, my master, never called him by his name, never called Imam Hussein a brother.
because he knows the position of Imam Hussein alayhi salam in the sight of Allah. He came to his brother, he says, Ya Sayyidi, my master, laka dhaqa sadri. I'm broken hearted. Why are you broken hearted, Ya Akhi? My brother, I said, Asma, I hear the scream of the children, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. Can you give me a chance to go and get water for those children? Imam Hussein alayhi salam said, Ya Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas, you are my backbone. I don't want you to be killed, then my entire army is gone. So be patient, Ya Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas. Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas went in response to the command and in the response of his master. They didn't go, he stayed there. After a while, the narration said, the scream of the children became even louder than before. He came to his master, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He said, oh my master, now I cannot handle this anymore. I heard the children, they screaming to the highest voice, saying, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. And I have to get them one. Imam Hussein alayhi salam said, no problem, go get them one. May Allah protect you, Ya Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas. Abul Fadl al-Abbas got himself ready. He sat on his horse. He took his way towards the river as he got on his way. And the narration said they have almost 4,000 men surrounded water. They surrounded Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Abul Fadl al-Abbas, he fought them. And don't be surprised, he had the blood of Imam Ali alayhi salam in him. He was able to get to the water. The narration said as he got to the water, he was thirsty. And as thirsty as he was so loyal to his brother and his master. He wanted to drink the water. He remembered his brother, Imam Hussein. He dropped the water and he said, I will not drink water when my master, Imam Hussein, is still standing there under the tent, under the heat. And as thirsty as I am, he dropped the water. He filled the jars. He carried the jars. He sat on his horse on his way back to the tent. The narration said they surrounded Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Now it was even worse than before because they want to make sure that that water doesn't get to the tent of Imam Hussein. While Imam Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was fighting them, one of them came from behind. The narration said he was hiding behind the palm tree. All his attention is, all his focus is to cut the right hand of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. While Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was fighting, he came from behind and he struck the right arm of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. The hand fall down and Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas says, Wallahi in qata'tumu yamini fa inni uhami abadan an dini wa an imami sadiq al-yaqeen. He said, I swear by Allah, if you cut my right arm, he said, I am defending my religion, my deen. I'm defending the true Imam, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. But Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, he was managed to hold the water with the right, with the left arm. And all his focus was to get the water to the tent and to those children who are waiting for the water. The narration said, as he tried to step forward, the right arm is bleeding. The narration said that another man came and he struck the left arm, فَقَطَعَهَا, and the right arm, the left arm also fell off. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas said, وَاللَّهِ إِن قَتَعْتُمُ يَسَارِ فَإِنِّي أُحَامِي أَبَدًا عَنْ دِينِي وَعَنْ إِمَامِ صَادِقِ الْيَقِينِ. I swear by Allah that if you cut my left arm, I'm defending nothing by the religion, and also I'm defending the true Imam, my brother, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The narration says Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, with that commitment that he gave to those children, he still wanted to get the water to the tent. He managed to hold the jaws over his mouth and trying to make sure that the water gets to those children who were thirsty and waiting for him. The narration said, then one of them said to the enemies, do not let the water get to the tent of Imam Hussein. Then one of them took his arrow out and faced towards that jar. And then he struck the jar and the entire water spilled. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was sitting on his horse, no two arms to fight and defend himself, and no water to take it to those children that he promised. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was sitting on his horse. The narration said, then the sword and the arrow started coming towards him, كَرَشْقِ الْمَطَرِ, like the rain coming from the sky. until one of them came and struck Abu al-Fadl Abbas on the head. Abu al-Fadl Abbas then fell on the ground. While he was falling, he said, "Assalamu alayka ya Sayyidi." Oh, peace be upon you, my master, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He fell on the ground, all covered with blood and the sand. Imam Hussein heard that call. He rushed to his brother. The narration said, by the time he got there, some of them were on Abu al-Fadl Abbas. Imam Hussein tried to keep them away from his brother. And he picked his brother, Abu al-Fadl Abbas. Abu al-Fadl Abbas was covered with blood and sand. He didn't know who picked him up. And he said, with a very low voice and very sad voice, he said, "Ya hada uqsim alayka biman ta'bud," whoever you are. He said, "I ask you for whomever you worship and you believe in, do not kill me until I say goodbye to my brother." This word was like a revolution in the heart of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. When Imam Hussein heard this, the narration said he busted into tears and he said to him, "Ana akhuka al-Hussein," I'm your brother al-Hussein. I'm not the enemy of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. Then Imam Hussein alayhi salam lifted his head and put on his thigh to comfort him at his last moment. The narration stated that Abu al-Fadl Abbas moved his head. He put the second time to comfort him in that difficult moment. He moved the head for three times. And then Imam Hussein asked him, "Ya Abu al-Fadl, why do you keep moving your head on my thigh while I want to comfort you in this difficult moment, in this last moment of yours?" Imam Hussein alayhi salam's response, Abu al-Fadl Abbas' response was, "Now I have you to put my head on your thigh. But in few minutes when you become shaheed, who will be there to put your head on their thigh to comfort you?" Imam Hussein alayhi salam cried, Abu al-Fadl Abbas. They both cried. Imam Hussein alayhi salam said to his brother, "Ya Abu al-Fadl Abbas, let me take you to the tent." Imam Hussein alayhi salam, when he said this to his brother, Abu al-Fadl Abbas said, "La, I ask you for the sake of Allah, do not take me to the tent." "Why, Ya Abu al-Fadl?" I said, "I feel shy to meet those children that I promised water. And here I am, I did not fulfill my promise, Ya Hussein. How can I meet them? How can I look at them?" Imam Hussein alayhi salam, when he heard these words, he bursted into tears. That Abu al-Fadl Abbas, even in those times, in those difficult times, he felt guilty that he was not able to fulfill that promise to those children. Imam Hussein alayhi salam said, "I was looking at the face of my brother, Abu al-Fadl Abbas, and with the sand and the blood, I can still see the nur on the face of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. That is why he's known as Qamar Bani Hashim, the moon of Bani Hashim." Imam Hussein alayhi salam said, "As I was looking at his face, looking at the difficult time of my brother," he says, "فَإِذَا رَفَعَ," then Abu al-Fadl Abbas said, "أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ," I bear witness there is no God but Allah, "وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ," and I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Then Harishan said, when Abu al-Fadl Abbas said this, Imam Hussein said, "These are the last word I can hear from my brother. That is the last moment of my brother." I said, as soon as he said this, "My father to ruha," then his soul departed from his body. And Imam Hussein alayhi salam cried. Imam Hussein left the scene. The narration said, "Raja al Hussein ala wajin ghair al wajin ladhi dhahaba bih." I say Imam Hussein came back, not in the same look and the same shape that he came with. They said Imam Hussein came back, "Muhdawdab al dhahar." He was curved as he was walking back. And he said, "Al anan kasara dhahari." Now my backbone has been broken. "Kutila akhi Abu al-Fadl Abbas." My brother has been killed, Abu al-Fadl Abbas. "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. Ya Allah, we ask you, for the sake of these holy men that we just talk about, Abul Fadl Abbas, Imam Hussein, Ahl al-Bayt, Ya Allah, we ask you, the marhum, Zafar Hussein, Ya Allah, be pleased with him, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, let him be among those the Shafa' of Ahl al-Bayt will include, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Ya Allah, forgive his past, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, we all have marhumin and marhumat, be pleased with all of them, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, when our time comes to go, Ya Allah, let it be the best time of our lives, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Allahumma aghfir lil muslimin wal muslimat, wal mu'minin wal mu'minat, al-ahya'a minhum wal amwat, tabi'a Allahumma baynana wa baynahum bil khayrat, innaka mujibu al-da'awat, innaka qadhi al-hajat, innaka ala kulli shay'in qadir. إلى أموات المؤمنين والمؤمنات رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة مع الصلوات.